This is the VORON ZERO, a printer so small, but also so capable. This will be the machine with which I want to attempt to print a 10-minute 3D banshee. Let me tell you more about this awesome machine, how I built it, and where I really screwed up and probably need to rebuild it. Let's find out more. Guten Tag everybody, I'm Stefan, and welcome to CNC Kitchen. This all started on a recent The Meltzone podcast episode in which Tom and I somehow got onto the topic of printing really fast. I'm the impatient guy. If I want to have a part, I would rather have it in half of the time as having like double the print volume.
Build and for this a reason, VORON. You've sorry, seen the you build a VORON. You've seen the those right? Full CoreXY VORON. It's the printer everyone suggests if it's like, hey, I want a DIY print, and that thing is baller.
Build a VORON, he said, and this is what I did, even though I never heard of VORON before and just can't understand why. VORON is not a company that sells 3D printers. VORON is an open source project that started out as a one-person operation to build a non-compromised 3D printer that is quiet, clean, and pretty, and capable of operating for long amounts of time without constant tinkering. Over the years, the engineering team, the community, and also the number of VORON 3D printers grew. They do have different size machines, from the big and scalable VORON 2.4 to the mini VORON ZERO. You might be curious why I didn't choose the popular V2.4, and there is a reason. My goal with this build was not to build a universal 3D printer. I wanted to have a very fast prototyping machine, and a fast motion system needs to be lightweight, stiff, and powerful. I'm impatient, and even though I own a ton of 3D printers, it always bothers me if printing a single part for a project I'm working on takes a couple of hours, because that means that I can only iterate the design once or maybe twice a day. Even worse, often the design might already be outdated once the print finished. 80% of my prints fit on a 100 by 100 mm build plate, so I wasn't looking for something huge. The VORON ZERO fits that very well with its 100 mm cubed printing volume and a tiny footprint of only 230 by 230 mm. It also makes use of a fast CoreXY motion system and uses linear rails for all axes, which is great because that adds quite some rigidity. Even though a tiny direct extruder is currently in development for the V0, I was particularly interested in the stock Bowden system because it takes away quite some weight from the print head. The less weight that needs to be moved, the faster you can accelerate, and the stiffer the motion system, the more precise the moves will be due to higher frequency resonances. To be clear, I know that people already printed sub 10 minutes banshees, but I'll be totally okay with a decently looking 10 minutes one for the moment. This video won't be covering the journey to that goal, because there were and still are some complications I want to dedicate separate videos on. So make sure to subscribe and select the notification bell if you don't want to miss that. As I said in the beginning, VORON doesn't sell printers or even parts. There aren't any official sellers of full kits, not even to speak of completely built printers. So I had to source the necessary parts for the build myself. The VORON website provides a great sourcing guide for parts that they tested and highly recommend for the build. Following their guide is probably the best method to end up with a printer that works as it's supposed in the end. I, unfortunately, just didn't have the time and patience to source all of the individual parts myself, and that's why I browsed around and found a decently looking full kit from Formbot on AliExpress. With a price of $400 plus an additional 50 bucks for shipping, I thought that this couldn't contain the worst of all parts if I didn't get ripped off. Shipping took around 2 weeks until I had the box on my doorstep. Just on a side note, after reading a bit in the VORON Discord, I realized that there are also quite a bunch of local shops worldwide that at least sell some parts, like mortar kits or pre-cut extrusions for the VORON. So if you go the self-sourcing route, make sure to inform yourself. While the package was in transit, I used the time to print all of the required parts that can be downloaded from GitHub, because that was something that's not included in the kit. The STLs come marked as accent and non-accent parts. The accent parts are usually printed in color, while the other parts are printed black or whatever other color combination you like. It's recommended to print all of the parts in ABS because the VORON can get pretty hot on the inside, especially with a full enclosure. Since my primary plan is not to run it enclosed, I used FireRed PETG for the accent parts and for the other parts carbon fiber nylon. There is a reason, especially for the latter choice. So, as I said previously, I was looking for a really stiff setup, and the carbon fiber nylon from Fiber 3 that I used is more than 5 times more rigid than ABS. Felix from Fiber 3 very kindly provided a bunch of their PACF Pro material for the build. Since I still had a more than 2 years old rolls of the same material around, I thought I saved the new ones and printed the parts out of leftovers, which will haunt me really badly soon. The VORON parts are designed beautifully and printed without any supports. I used 4-5 perimeters for the parts and 60% infill to make them strong. Carbon fiber nylon prints so great, and if you keep it dry, so easily. Even though pure nylon might be a pain to print, as soon as you add chopped carbon fibers to the mix, most filaments barely warp anymore. Think about that when you next time see somebody print really high performance polymers like PEEK or PEI in the even cooler form with carbon fibers. That's often not primarily to add strength, but it's often just used for making it properly printable. Unfortunately, I don't have any footage of the package that arrived with my VORON kit, because it smelled so badly of freshly cut acrylic that I had to quickly rip it open and put the parts outside for venting. A couple of days later, I started with the build. The parts delivered in the kit didn't look bad at all. There was a Meanwell PSU, LDO stepper motors, an SKR Mini E3 V2, Gates belts, a Raspberry Pi, a V6 hot end including a titanium heat break, a removable PEI powder coated bed, and a full parts kit for the dual drive pocket watch extruder. The sheets for the enclosure were transparent and black 2.5mm acrylic, and all the screws came in labeled bags. The extrusions were cut to pretty much exactly the length and pre-drilled and tapped. Only at that point I realized how tiny the machine is really going to be. The extrusions were only 15x15mm instead of the common 20x20mm ones, the motors were NEMA 14 instead of the NEMA 17, and the linear rails also were way smaller than I thought. I won't go over the full build, because I don't want to bore you to death. If you're interested in a full build video series, check out and subscribe to Narrow 3DP's channel. You find a huge collection of videos about all of the VORONs, and also things like Klipper, input shaper, and much more. All in all, the build took me a good 10 to 15 hours, including wiring. Some parts are really small on the V0, so if you rather have bear claws than hands, maybe check out the bigger VORON models. Still, the build was a real pleasure. Some might call the machine over-engineered, but I'll just call it well-engineered. Nothing seems to be superficial, and belt tightening is super handy with the nuts. Besides one cross drill in the extrusions missing, two little M2 nuts, and the grub screw of one pulley missing, the Formbot kit I bought really contained everything I needed. The printer can be fully enclosed, and mine came with all of the side panels, but since I probably run into cooling issues, in the sense that I don't have enough cooling, I so far didn't install the panels and the top cover yet. So for the top cover, I have a really interesting idea. I want to put an activated charcoal and HEPA filter in it to avoid the smell and dangerous particles when printing ABS or PC. VORON provides a build manual for the whole process, though it's not super detailed, and I regularly had to check the CAD model for clarification. Unfortunately, that also stops at the point when it's time to install the electronics. There is also a setup guide that includes wiring diagrams, but no best practice on how to route the wires. So cable routing and management is up to you. At that point, it's a good idea to have joined the VORON Discord, where the members will happily help you out if you have any questions. Rather than building and using the pocket watch extruder, for which all the parts were included in my kit, I put an E3D Hemera in its bottom configuration into the machine that fits perfectly. There is no particular reason to not use the included extruder on the machine as a start. I just had the Hemera lying around. I also didn't use the included V6 hotend because that's limited to around 12 to 15 cubic millimeters extrusion rate, and I'll need more. Adding a volcano hotend isn't really an option because that would take away quite a bit of the already limited 120 millimeters sea height. And also, since it's dangling around that much, is, in my opinion, not a very good choice for fast printing. The VORON files came with STLs for three different hotend options, the V6, a Dragon hotend, and the Slice Engineering Mosquito. So I reached out to my friends at Slice Engineering and asked if they'd like to sponsor a Mosquito hotend for the build. In its standard configuration, it's already capable of slightly higher extrusion rates than the V6. If you additionally use the Magnum heat break, you significantly increase the melt zone to push out way more material per time than in the stock configuration. I estimated and noticed that I need around 30 cubic millimeters a second for my 10-minute 3D Banshee. So a more capable hotend was a must for me. To finish the electronics, a soldering iron, and probably also a crimping tool to attach the plugs to the end of the cables are a must. You'll have to make sure that the cable chain is short enough that it won't clash with the X-axis during homing. You should also definitely install the thermal fuse to the bed to avoid overheating problems. The power cable of the silicone mat included in my kit is also too thick that I wasn't able to fit a ground wire through the cable chain, so I ended up with a separate ground wire for now. Since the bed heater is AC, you shouldn't omit it because it's a potential electrification risk. Talking about AC, the bed is controlled via a solid state relay. Ensure that you have one that is on in its high state. Otherwise, it will start heating the bed right when you turn the machine on if you use the standard configuration, probably until you notice it or your thermal fuse blows. I noticed it early enough to avoid damage, but mine still was an active low one. But I talked to Formbot and they'll probably start shipping active high ones for future kits. One thing where I'm not particularly happy about the VORON ZERO is that there is no cover for the electronics compartment, and on the PSU as well on the SSR there are exposed live wires. I enclosed the SSR and need to figure out something for the PSU to not shock myself while picking it up. Wire management and routing looked pretty nice in the end with the help of those adhesive cable clamps. The last step was flashing the firmware. Even though you could run the machine with a standard installation of Marlin, the firmware of choice is Klipper, and that's also the reason why a Raspberry Pi is included in a standard build. Contrary to most other firmwares, Klipper is not running on the control board itself, but on the faster Raspberry Pi, which then does all of the complex path planning for cool custom features like pressure advance and input shaping. The control board then only passes on the step signals to the drivers. Klipper is usually interfaced with Octoprint or the even more custom-made applications Mainsail or Fluid. I went with Octoprint just because I'm familiar with it and its configuration, and I want to use plugins like Octolabs. Installing Klipper is well documented, but will require you to use a couple of shell commands to install it and compile the custom firmware. Configuration is done via a config file that can easily be accessed via Octoprint and in which the printer itself, steppers, directions, currents, speeds, etc. are configured. I had to change a couple of settings until my printer moved into the right direction, and at least for my active low SSR had to change that setting as well. Once that was working, it was finally the time to get to printing. The first print should always be the VORON cube, of which you post a video on Reddit to get your official serial number. When homing the V0 for the first time, I didn't even hear it moving because the TMC2209 make it so silent. There is no bed probe, so leveling is all done manually via three screws. I started with PLA and got really beautiful print results, but as soon as I started printing faster, the material showed that it needs a ton of cooling that the two 30mm fans just can't provide. Even though movements are silent, as soon as the fans start kicking in, the machine is not the most quiet if you don't fully enclose it. I then switched over to PETG, which was already behaving better in terms of cooling, though somehow the stringing just didn't want to go away. Even though I hadn't enclosed the printer yet, I put a roll of extruder ABS on it and, well, wow, was impressed with the printing results. Beautiful and highly detailed prints at easily double the speed compared to the speed profile on a Prusa Mark III. The combination of lightweight and stiff motion system plus the use of Klipper produced some really beautiful prints. Again, here without any serious tuning. I ran with 120mm to 150mm a second, accelerations of 4000mm squared, and got parts that don't even show huge signs of ringing or other speed artifacts. That's even without the use of input shaper. To get these nice ABS results, I also used the auto cooling feature in Prusa Slicer that turns the part cooling fan on the shorter a layer takes to print. Yes. Cooling and ABS seem to work well on the VORON so far, though I didn't print any huge models yet. Unfortunately, with ABS, that was when my problems that I mentioned in the beginning started. I already noticed before that it seemed that I regularly had to retighten basically all screws, and by an amount that is more than you'd consider settling. So this is probably material creep. For parts that got warm, it was even more obvious. With the heat from the bed, the carrier itself quickly started severely deforming, and I had to re-level the bed basically after every print. Honestly, that's probably mostly my fault because I was so focused on using the super stiff and super strong carbon fiber nylon for the mechanical parts. Felix from Fiber3 warned me that this is an issue with the older batches, and that was recently fixed, but the spool of material I used was more than 2.5 years old. And thinking about it, I even had the same issue on my CPU cooler bracket I printed in the past. I think this is one beautiful or nasty example of material creep. So the slow, permanent deformation of a part under constant load. The material flows away where it's loaded, so I lost all of the pretension in my bolts. And since creep is a function of time and temperature, it even led to the whole bed carrier deforming under its own weight. I think this is also finally the time to perform my constantly postponed creep test for 3D printing materials. Before I continue my endeavors towards the 10 minutes 3D Benchy, I'll reprint all of the parts and reassemble the printer. However, I'm currently not 100% sure which material to use. Fiber3's new carbon fiber or glass fiber nylon, ABS, PETG, or some kind of polycarbonate. I really don't know. What's your opinion? So I'll have to end this right here for now, though still wanted to show you that the VORON ZERO is a really beautiful, well-engineered and capable small little printer. It's probably not suitable for everyone with its tiny print volume, but should still be plenty big for many applications where speed, quality, and high performance polymers are involved. Sourcing the parts and putting everything together is a considerable amount of work, and not everyone might be happy with wiring electronics or even working with mains voltage. The $450 I invested in the kit was well spent in my opinion. And I'm looking forward to the tuning that it still required to get to my final goal, because my fastest Benchy still sits at around 20 minutes. But what do you think? Where do you see upgrade potential and bottlenecks on my way to the 10 minutes Benchy? And would this be a machine that suits your needs? Post a comment down below. Links to the VORON website, assembly and sourcing guide, Discord, and also the kit I bought are down in the description. Thanks for watching, everyone. I hope you're all doing well. If you found this video helpful, then leave a like, share it with the community, and make sure that you subscribe for more. If you want to support my work, head over to Patreon, become a YouTube member, and take a look at my merch. Stay healthy, auf Wiedersehen, and I hope to see you in the next one.